Premonitions of Stormy Polynesia. So here we have, actually this is one of my more successful paintings. I started off by painting a canoe in a lagoon. And then I, as the word is scumble, you know, I painted over it with my usual, as you see these brush strokes, that's from a, that looks like a number 8 or 9 hog's hair bright. Now flat uses about that much brush, a bright uses only about that much. See, I wonder if you can see that. The bright is a shorter bristle, and the hog's hair is a good stiff bristle. Those guys were tough, those piggy poos. Anyway, so so we got with this. This one, this painting appeared in the Dr. Emmanuel's book, The Divine Wind, about hurricanes. And that's his coffee table book about hurricanes. And he found my painting. He was surfing through the net and saw my painting, liked it. And it's right there in his book. I think in the second, on the second page. Isn't that something? That's my biggest success with the oil painting so far. Every now and then I sell a painting for $300, which isn't too bad for an unknown artist. But I'm beginning to realize all this artwork has a much more useful situation. You just have to not worry about the income or the outgo. Okay, so it's also called hurricane. Greenwich Village, New York, back in say something like 05. No, actually. 05, what are you talking about, man? I got these disabilities. Pay no attention to that guy. Okay. Yeah, you can pay attention to me. It's like somewhat. Uh, 1966. Okay, finally got that down. At first, the painting was of a decorative canoe on a beach, and then I painted over the canoe with the present view that I showed you. When I was doing these paintings, I was sort of oblivious to what they were. When I looked at them drying on the apartment walls, I used to hang them all up there on the walls. I had the feeling that I could escape the city by going through them into the paintings themselves. You know, I felt like I had gone overboard on Lewis Carroll's Alice Through the Looking Glass concept of escaping one's world by entering a depiction of another. Now, I had never read the book. My mother read it to me there when we lived amid the ruins of post-war Germany on Wolfgangstrasse in Frankfurt. I read the Rupert the Bear comic book I found in the closet when we moved there. Something else English. Yeah, Rupert the Bear, that was a pretty good comic, I'll tell you. Just sit there and read that. Okay, I was still a kid of 7 back in those days. I can't begin to describe the incredible concept I encountered when the passages of Looking Glass were being read to me about the girl climbing up on the mantel and pressing against the mirror and subsequently being able to poke her head through into the reverse world of the one she was in. It was kind of like feeling glass turn to water that was suspended vertically. From then on, it was something I very much wanted to do. Like from age 7, you know. For me, memories feel less like recollections and more like actual places of the real actual visits to the real past. You see, at that age and younger, a child's mind produces its own mild hallucinogens. But if we can step away from our fallible know-it-all attitudes for a second and realize that this world is a very fluid existence, we can begin to realize that it is possible that Alice's mirror has a good chance of being actually existent in one form or another. I mean, you've got to have more respect for these worlds than any of us normally tend to have. You can't just go ramrodding your way through life and expect to really get anywhere, you know. Life is so much more than that, you know. If we're preoccupied with what we observe in the immediate frame of reference, we're only looking at the equipment for the journey, you know. So by having the story read to me and considering it in my 7-year-old's mind with the appropriate natural ingredients to use the passage as a vehicle to punctuate the full impression of the bigger story being relayed to me at that time, at that same time, that 1953 springtime afternoon in the Germanic latitudes, something clicked. I connected. And I would subsequently find myself sitting in my Greenwich Village studio circa 1966 with the sensation that I could go through my finished paintings on the wall all the time, amused at what seemed to be disproportionate imagination back then. But now it's hindsight, which tacticians and politicians are wont to say is 100%. And hindsight helps me verify the impression. Whoa, feel a slight earthquake. Hope it's just going to be slight. The last one we went through, actually I knew it was going to happen before it did. It's like, I'm not going to be sitting here because there's this huge air conditioning unit right overhead. But now it's hindsight, which the tacticians and politicians are wont to say is 100%. Hindsight helps me verify. Man, verification. What they were, I was experiencing when I did the paintings, you see. The best term I can yet come up with is premonitions. So in hindsight, I can say that teenage kid really did his job back there in 66. I was only 19 and sensing some incredible urgency, putting everything I could into getting that artwork done, not worrying about perfectionism, not worrying about realism. It was as though I was painting windows to my future. So we got a tilter there. Okay, I think that's okay. Now, if it may seem that I'm accounting this with an air of certainty, I'm not really, you know. I mean, it's arguable that it could have been a coincidence that I did all these paintings that somehow coincided with subsequent travels. But the more I consider these past works of art of mine, the more convinced I become of such certainty. I do know that I definitely had the premonition that I would travel extensively. Yeah, I can actually remember that. often with little more than a toothbrush and a guitar. Yep, I was getting that even before I was in the studio. Okay, the guitar I sensed. The toothbrush I insisted upon. Even then, after a while, I stopped brushing my teeth for a while. And that is a disaster. You want to make sure you got good dental hygiene. The big thing is your interdental. Remember that. In between those teeth, that's where you need to do the brush. The brush won't get there. What you do is you wiggle the brush so the bristles work their way into the gaps of between the teeth and then flick to the end of the teeth. Wiggle in and flick. But the big thing you've got to do is get that dental floss and go in between the teeth with the dental floss and work underneath where the tooth is goes to slightly below the gum line. And you got to have a long piece about that big. Wind it around your finger. Be careful not to cut off the circulation in your fingertip. And you take and wind off one finger and wind onto the other finger so you have a new section of dental floss. You don't want to be doing the same teeth with the same dental floss. A lot of the phenomenon of I was going to make a video of this. I may not have a chance to do it, so I'll do this now. Real quick. Tooth loss. Abscess. The latest thinking is that abscess is contagious. And it may be latent in an area. For example, Claremont, New Hampshire. Back in the 18th, 17th centuries, there was this oppression of workers at the mills along the river there in that Claremont area. There was a very big rapids area, perfect for powering industry that was run off leather belts and paddle wheels. And it was a outsourcing of the English textile industry to the colonies there, and the colonial women were pressed into service there. They went in there by the hundreds, operating these mills for their whole lives, living this draconian existence, not even a break, not even going to the bathroom, no lunch break. I actually talked to one of these women out there at the end of the 1800s, she was what was it called? That one of these 100-year-old ladies. I sat there and talked to her at the hospital, and she related to me what the working conditions were like. There, you had a situation under that stress where you had a lot of tooth decay building up. And some very powerful organisms that tend to spread with the gingivitis, periodontitis, and then finally the abscess infections. So you got to be very careful about this. That's where it's good to have something like Listerine. Listerine is made from Lister's antiseptic that he first developed for operating theaters. Before then, it was a huge incidence of death. The operation would be a success, but the patient would die of infection until Lister found out you had to disinfect the operating theater, and he would spray this Listerine disinfectant there, which makes also a good mouthwash. It's non-toxic. Anyway, so yeah, dental hygiene is important. I don't know why I went into that here. Oh yeah, the toothbrush. You know, best thing to do is put that toothbrush in your shirt pocket if you got one. It's exposed to air. Air is a very good disinfectant. Okay, but it's so very exciting to come to the realization that it's all somehow connected. Now, that you can be safe in saying. Yes, there is a connection to the future. It's around you. And you can acquire at least a significant threshold of sensitivity to begin to at least perceive it somehow. It is not some kind of haphazard thing that only happens when the time comes. No, there are certain things that, at least certain things, hundreds of years ahead, definitely, you can see them from here. Gift of prophecy? Well, I call it premonitions here. Okay, you can actually do paintings of it. Okay? It's all somehow connected. It's exciting to come to the realization that it's all somehow connected, that, yeah, I went through the painting, quote-unquote, through the painting. So, it was a busy morning at the chief's hut. In those days, it was a building without walls, built in the traditional way there in Sa'amoa, in Tutuila Island there, Ili'ili. Okay. Visitors sat at the fourth pole from the left of the entrance. There I was helping out. At the time, in early 1979, I was oblivious of the painting I had done 13 years earlier. For all I knew, my art career was over. The rug jerked out from under me by the so-called, quote-unquote, Vietnam era. I had done 3 oil paintings in Fiji, where I was kicked out by the immigration officials almost a year earlier. They would be stolen in Indonesia in 1983. I had done a series of drawings in Samoa after I left the chief's village. They were lost along the way, just like most of my artwork. But that morning in that Samoan village, everyone was getting ready for a storm, a tropical storm. It hit that afternoon. The house without walls had a hidden quality I hadn't noticed when I was there. It really did have walls, only they were folded up in the roof area. They were handmade out of coconut tree leaves, which are large, huge. In fact, a whole branch is like a leaf. You know, the people had woven them in such a way that they slid down on lines like Venetian blinds and became walls. It was an indigenous device developed right there. On a normal day at twilight, you know, it was really something. You could see the chief's color TV miles away while you walked down the road approaching his house. But this was not a normal day. This day, the house had walls. I imagine that these walls would be defenseless in the brunt of a tropical storm, but they held out quite well. It was almost a cozy feeling as the storm hit its peak and everything remained intact. I mean, you had to be there to see it. I wonder if the Western-style house we built later, you know, next door, would have held out as well. You know, it's arguable that the louvered glass windows may have actually broken. You know, it's taken me back, well, it's taken me this long to realize that perhaps it was this storm I was depicting back in the 1966 Greenwich Village studio, like a Nostradamus of my own future. Like an Alice through the looking glass, I depicted the island, the storm, the coconut tree leaves, and the canoe the ancestors arrived in. Buried in the past.